Morning friends, we are just going to go very briefly into the unit operations which we already have done. So basically this is what we saw there is a chemical feed. Chemicals are added for coagulation or flocculation and disinfection, sometimes also to improve the feed quality. So these are the things which we usually use the chemical feed for. We have a rapid mix, we have also, that's called flash mixing. That's also, this is coagulation and flocculation. Coagulation, you add some coagulating agents which make the small particles to come together. You may add flocculant so that it forms flocs which you can remove from the water. Then there's sedimentation, big particles are allowed to sediment. And filtration, where you pass it through a filter media. Filter media will hold off all the substances which cause turbidity and particulate materials, and also inorganic material. So please remember, this activated carbon is not a disinfectant. It is an absorbing agent. Absorption is a surface phenomena. On the surface of it, it can take many of the chemicals, and many of the inorganic chemicals get absorbed on it. So taste and flavor get improved because inorganic materials get absorbed on the surface of activated carbon. Okay, so then we have this filtration and disinfection. Yes, you know what disinfection is. The most primitive, or what I'll say is the one of the oldest disinfection technique is chlorination at home.
Boiling.
Boiling. In fact, somebody had sent a message on WhatsApp also. In the rains, if you are stuck, take water in the pressure cooker, 15 whistles, even the worst of the pathogen is going to get killed. Okay, that is also called as autoclaving. Okay, that was the message. So I'm just putting what they told me, and I'm sure that you will understand that it is one of the most effective methods of treatment. So we were talking about subsurface sources. Infiltration galleries are nothing but, sometimes they are like huge rooms itself with holes into which water can collect. It will form a channel and then they collect the water. Cisterns and tanks are used for storing water, or rainwater specifically. Okay, so in India we usually call them as tanks. If you're using some of the foreign author books, they're using the word cistern. So in every village we actually have a temple. Normally there's a huge tank, and almost in most of the cases, if we are not interfering with nature, you'll find that the tank is going to be filled. So basically what is happening nowadays, all of us want to have the comfort of having the water from our own house. So we dig a deep well, and if you remember, in hydrology you would have studied that around the well there is a local depression of the water. So if this keeps on happening, the groundwater itself keeps reducing, and all these tanks are getting empty. So anyway, so these are the things where this is how the wells normally get contaminated. This is the way the wells normally get contaminated. So what do we mean by the sewage disposal system? For instance, if you are having a septic tank very close to your borewell, you are definitely going to pollute your borewell. Okay, so this is just a simple example, but there are other sewage disposal methods also, which when the thing is a subsurface system, you are going to have the water getting contaminated by pathogens like whatever is in the sewage. Okay, especially coliforms, what we are talking about, coliforms, and they cause diarrhea and all the diseases. And how do we do these wells? How do we dig wells? You know that, right? So traditional methods are there, bore wells are there now, and then we also have chemical contaminants. Okay, for example, in any of these, near these pharmaceutical companies, whatever they put in, including like these pesticides, no, they all get washed down into the water. Pesticides don't break down easily. Their chemical structure is such that it's so strong, it will not break down easily. So, and also they are water soluble. In fact, that's what they want. They want it in a way that all these insects will get the pesticide. In the process, we also start to get the pesticides. Oil and oil products, I don't know if suppose you are familiar, but in the NOR side, there's a huge refinery. Madras refineries, MRL, now I think they call it Chennai refineries, whatever. But they have huge pipes conveying oil from the port to the refinery facility. Some of these pipes have got leaks. So all these leaks have spoiled the groundwater in that entire area. Kurukpet, I think, is the name of the place. So people were all complaining that they are having oil. Very sad, no? We are saying no oil, these fellows are complaining about oil. Anyway, so can you think of the remediation? It's very difficult. So this has also gone into the groundwater. And biological agents are many. In fact, what I was reading somewhere, nowadays we are digging a borewell which goes very deep into the ground. Well water is one of the purest forms of water. Why? Because it is actually having a very huge sand filter. It goes through the sand filter before it reaches into the underground storages. Now what we are doing, we are drilling a hole. Any bacteria and virus can just go in and contaminate that source. So these biological agents and microbes are a very huge, very big problem, personally in my view. Next, we are having the domestic water. Domestic water problems, hardness doesn't let suds, it forms suds. Hardness also makes the water pass scaling in pipes. Most of you know, if suppose pipes keep dripping, you'll be able to see salt formation itself at that thing. This tap won't close properly. So all these are some problems which we have. And also it is this calcium and magnesium bicarbonates that cause it. And the issue is, you can also get things like kidney stones and stuff like that. So we cannot actually, it's not acceptable. Okay, so we usually use something like probably zeolite processes at home. Okay, EDTA, all those things may be possible on a very large scale. You would have studied this in chemistry. So now on a home level, for iron and manganese also, we use this zeolite columns. Okay, so it will remove the iron and manganese. The problem is it will cause that yellowish stains and all these. And of course, they're not also good for human consumption in large quantities. And turbidity filters, activated carbon, that will take care of it. And also the other filters. If you look at your AquaGuard and all these units, you'll have a pre-filter. So it's nothing but layers of some membrane which is there. And you pass through the membrane, you get a clear water. Then corrosive water, it corrodes the pipes, steel pipes will get corroded. So you'll have to add some basic substance to make it to neutralize it. Taste, it's not taste and water, taste in water. Okay, taste and odor also. It should have been taste and odor. I don't remember. I don't understand how I made it that way. And detergents, you know what they are? Salty water. And oils, pesticides, and chemicals from factories. So places like Bhopal and all, including the groundwater everywhere, you are having problem. Okay. Now, so these are the techniques of desalination. Okay, you are having ion exchange, you are having electrodialysis, you are having reverse osmosis, and you have ultrafiltration. Okay, so I am going to add this also. Membrane techniques of water treatment. Okay, these are all water treatment techniques for domestic water, drinking water. So I want you to just go in for this. What are the membranes which are available commercially for our water treatment? Okay, so I am telling it again, it's not in your notes. Membrane techniques, you should be familiar. It's very simple. Since it's also first, it's all in first year chemistry, right? You didn't have that. Okay. In all these cases, in any case, you look up your books, study it, okay? Because it's very, very, very funda. Ion exchange, reverse osmosis, okay? Osmosis where...
water.
Yeah, that's because of the pressure gradient across a membrane. Okay, this is what osmosis from region of higher concentration to region of lower concentration goes. From here, you are going to do the vice versa. Then ultrafiltration, it's nothing but passing it through very fine, in order of few microns, they have pores. So only water can go through. In fact, bacteria gets filtered out of that, but some virus can go through it. And then you have electrodialysis. Dialysis is also a membrane like osmosis, so you just go through that. Distillation is one of the major techniques which are now being used. So in fact, they've got some places where they have huge domes, okay, for distilling water. And then based on the solar energy, the water goes up, it gets condensed in a dome and it slides to the sides. So salt gets formed in the chamber and water is taken out. So sometimes they freeze the water and then they are able to, they do it at a eutectic point. Okay. So at that time they are able to separate the salt and water, and then they are getting some fresh water. Same thing, some chemicals can be added to, depends on the feed, you add some chemicals and then you are going to get the fresh water. I am not going to ask you about this chemical treatment method, but I'd like you to know this membranes. Look at the distillation methods, okay, and crystallization. Crystallization technique is nothing but you form crystals of the material which is inside, and with materials that cause the hardness in water or the salts which is dissolved in water, and they remove it. Next is pre-treatment of water. So basically, if hard water is there, the performance of the treatment plant is very badly affected. So we try to remove the hardness. Okay, it might be EDTA method or any method, depending on the degree of hardness and depending on the efficiency they want the hardness done. Then you've got coagulation, and then you run the filtration, microfiltration, ultrafiltration are done to remove the particles that cause turbidity. Okay, any of the floating particles can be removed by using these techniques. And then please remember, activated carbon is only to remove chemicals. Okay, chemicals. I don't know whether I can call that as microfiltration. I don't know, because many times activated carbon is a small size particle only. Okay, but microfiltration normally, by what I have read, because I'm not an expert, frankly, in water treatment, and. Microbes.
Okay,
micro impurities. What happens in activated carbon is, whenever you are having something like a chemical agent, okay, so the concentration is very, very less, which you can't normally remove with the ordinary thing. So in that case, yes, I bow. Your argument that it's microfiltration will hold water. I agree. But I can't put it under the same category, because the principle of activated carbon is, it is a surface phenomenon. The other one is a barrier. Sizes above a particular size is not allowed to go through. Okay, so if you look at your sieve analysis, it's a mechanical process by which it is held out. But here it's a chemical phenomena. Adsorption is used to hold it. So how it is going to matter, whether it's ultra or micro, I don't care. But what I want you to know is, this is a surface phenomena that's more of a mechanical phenomena. Sometimes you suck the water with a lot of vacuum pressure through the pores and then take it. Or you create a high pressure on the outside so that the water tries to go in through the, you squeeze the water in through the pores. Please remember that video which we had yesterday with that water droplet that was saying, no, ow, this is very painful. She made to squeeze through. Next, we're having pH balance. Okay, again, many of the processes, for instance, I will just revisit again coagulation and all these things. You will find that there's something called zeta potential. I have not talked about zeta potential, but I hope, I want you to go and look into your book for the word zeta potential. Okay, in fact, you might even take it as an important thing because I am making a note of this right in front of you guys. I don't know where I am going to ask, but I am bound to ask this sometime. I want you to do this zeta potential. What is the zeta potential? Basically, we are telling that we have to form flocks, and all these are small particles which have to get agglomerated. Nice word again. I am using words which I didn't know I knew. Okay, good. Now, agglomeration is to enhance the process. You can just form. You can have a electric current passed through the liquor. Liquor means the fluid which is there in the chamber. We have a zeta potential. Okay, in coagulation, you will be able to see this. Yes. See, this all enhances the efficiency. This all enhances the efficiency of the process. It makes it go quickly, basically. Okay, so that's why we can use that. But just remember, in one of the videos, they had that coagulation agents. They ran water with very high speed. Did you notice how the settling took place? It was so rapid. So nowadays, the materials which we have, sometimes polymers are being used. We have very good and very effective materials nowadays. But to get it to work, pH should be there at a particular level. If suppose there is a lot of turbidity, okay, the larger size particles are there, they may disturb the process. So that is why we will have to choose mix and match to get a right fit. In this course, we have to know that such a thing exists. How it is going to, or what is going to be done, might be important if you are going to take a public health engineering or a environmental engineering course as your master's. So there you'll be having to know what and what should be put together, what and what should not be mixed together, or you can yourself design a new system which you can which will work. Now I'm just going to go through a drinking water plant video again, so I hope you enjoy it.
Welcome to our tour of Winnipeg's drinking water supply and treatment system. We use leading edge technology to treat the water as it passes through many stages, including coagulation.
I'll just play this again because I'm sorry, the volume was turned down low.
Welcome to our tour of Winnipeg's drinking water supply and treatment system. We use leading edge technology to treat the water as it passes through many stages, including coagulation, flocculation, dissolved air flotation, filtration, and three types of disinfection. Our system protects public health by virtually eliminating the risk of waterborne disease and reducing the level of harmful disinfection byproducts. It also improves the taste, odor, and appearance of our tap water. Shoal Lake has been our source of water since 1919. It's located 136 kilometers from Winnipeg at the Manitoba-Ontario border and is approximately 92 meters higher than Winnipeg. Water flows downhill from Shoal Lake through an aqueduct into four large reservoirs next to the treatment plant. The aqueduct is a large concrete pipe that carries up to 386 million liters of water per day to the reservoirs. The reservoirs hold up to 8.8 billion liters of water, which on average is enough to supply Winnipeg for about 30 days. Water flows from the reservoirs through two large pipes into powerful pumps that move the water into the plant for treatment. This $300 million state-of-the-art facility features a highly automated system that monitors and controls a wide variety of instruments, mechanical equipment, and electrical equipment, including 40 processors, 140 pumps, 2,300 valves, and 1,400 instruments. It can treat up to 400 million liters of water per day. In this first step, we add sulfuric acid and ferric chloride as the water flows into the plant. Sulfuric acid lowers the pH of the water and makes this stage of treatment more efficient. Ferric chloride, a coagulant, causes the naturally occurring particles of organic material in the water to attract each other. The water enters flocculation basins, where large mixers slowly stir the water, causing the particles to collide and stick together, creating large clumps. Now that large clumps have been formed in the water, the next step is to remove them. We do this in dissolved air flotation tanks. We inject a stream of water, supersaturated with air, into the flocculated water which is flowing into the bottom of the tanks. Tiny air bubbles are released into the water and carry the clumps to the top of the tanks. Skimmers remove the floating clumps from the surface of the water. The clumps are pumped to an area for further processing. The treated water is collected from the bottom of the tanks. The water flows from the dissolved air flotation tanks to chambers where ozone is added. This step, called ozonation, does three things. It provides the first level of disinfection by destroying most of the harmful bacteria. It improves the filter performance in the next treatment stage. And it improves the taste and odor of the water. We make ozone by applying electricity to liquid oxygen. At the end of the ozone chambers, we add sodium bisulfite to the ozonated water to remove any leftover ozone. The water now flows into filter tanks containing biologically activated carbon. The filters remove any remaining small particles in the water, including parasites. Good bacteria growing on the filters remove some of the remaining dissolved organic material. This reduces the level of disinfection byproducts in the water. We clean the filters regularly by pumping air and water backwards through them. The backwashed water is pumped to an area for additional processing. The filtered water flows into the chlorine contact chamber for a second round of disinfection. We add chlorine to kill viruses and bacteria such as E. coli that might be in the water. Chlorine is the most widely used drinking water disinfectant in North America and has been used for more than 100 years. We then add sodium hydroxide to bring back the pH of the water close to the original level. The water flows from the chlorine contact chamber into an underground reservoir called the Clearwell. We disinfect the water once again using ultraviolet or UV light. We pump the water through six stainless steel chambers, each containing 9 ultraviolet lamps. The lamps are similar to fluorescent bulbs. With only seconds of exposure, the UV light rays penetrate any remaining parasites, such as Cryptosporidium or Giardia. The UV light renders these parasites harmless. After UV disinfection, the water flows into two large pipes where we add fluoride to help prevent tooth decay. We also add orthophosphate to form a protective coating inside water pipes. This coating helps reduce corrosion that may add lead to tap water. The two large pipes carry the treated water to our 3 reservoirs and pumping stations in the city. We add chlorine again as the water is pumped into the distribution system to ensure that the water remains disinfected until it reaches your tap. The final stage of treatment is to deal with the materials removed from the water by the treatment processes. The backwash water from the filters is allowed to stand until the solid materials settle. We then send the clean water back to the beginning of the treatment process. We pump the settled out material from the filters and the clumps of particles from the dissolved air flotation process to outdoor settling ponds next to the treatment plant. The pond contents go through natural freeze-thaw cycles, which separate the liquid and solids. We pump the liquid into Winnipeg's sewer system for wastewater treatment and take the solids to the landfill for disposal. We test our water each step of the way, from Shoal Lake to your tap. Our testing program includes over 150 different tests at more than 130 different locations throughout the year. Because water quality is so important, we do more testing than the provincial government requires. Our certified professional team is dedicated to ensuring that our community enjoys safe,
high-quality drinking water that meets provincial regulatory requirements and falls well within Health Canada guidelines. We hope that you've enjoyed this tour of our drinking water supply and treatment system.
Great. So that was another drinking water system. What is unique about this plant?
They add octophosphate. Why do they add it? Prevent corrosion in the pipes,
that's right. What about you, Nikhil? Yes. So sterilization was much more in this. Okay. First thing is, please note that in this video, in this tour, they showed some more about the way they conditioned water for each stage. There was a pre-treatment. Sulfuric acid was added for some reason. Okay, this video again, this presentation is again coming to you. Okay, so why did they add sulfuric acid? Have a look at it. So all these other things which you told, have a look why they did it. Okay, so this is the most important thing which I feel was a difference between this treatment plant or others. And they also talked about the sludge handling in this. Till now, in all the other videos which we saw, nobody spoke about the way the sludge was being handled. Okay, so this is something which is interesting, and in fact, much more than whatever I would have spoken, these people have given it all. I'm not going to repeat what they told, but this short 10 minute or whatever was the length of that video, it conveyed much more of information than what I would have been able to pack in maybe 2 weeks or 3 weeks, because this is such a huge topic basically. Okay, I'm not worried about you guys, because I know you are going to have a look at this and just try to understand what is there. I'm going in for a couple of layouts. Okay, now suppose I'm asking about slow sand filter, for instance. I want a diagram like this indicating the main parts. Okay, what is there, what is not there. Okay, so the more information you draw in a diagram, the idea of what you got about the system is very clearly indicated. And when you write also, it will be ideal that you write point wise, so that I know if you're writing something wrong, I'll know it immediately. Even if you're writing the correct thing, it will be easier for me to gauge your understanding. Okay, so this will be the cross section and this will be the elevation of this. Now you just have a look at it. What is coming in through the pipe on your left, it comes in and then it forms a head over the filter bed. Okay, there's a filter bed, there's a line over here. Where's the mouse? Yes. So this line is the place where the sand filter starts, and then coming down a little, you will notice that there is a gravel bed. This is what they call as, they put it as graded gravel. That means the gravel size will start from a smaller size at top, then it will be increasing in size. This gravel will be very important in letting the water flow through the water to the filter media. This is very much important, and then it will be collected in this infiltration area, a pipe, and then it goes to the collection tank. So basically, this gives you a very clear picture of the sand filter. This is what we need. Is anything else required? Probably a backwash arrangement. Okay. So apart from that, you don't have the whole thing is clearly explained or it's self-explanatory. Backwash, nothing. There's another pipe. You just pour water through it. It will go in. The water will go in through pressure, and then it can go out. Okay. So that's what we have as the backwash arrangement. Okay. Now the next slide I have is a typical layout of a plant. So the entire plant is being put here. Okay, so this is coagulation basin one, coagulation, I'm pointing on my computer. Coagulation basin number one, coagulation basin number two, filter number one, filter number two, okay, drain, etc. is all marked here. Okay, so this has been taken from a textbook. Again, here you are having a cross section of the coagulation of the coagulation basin, and then you got a chemical feed area, and then filter operating room. Okay, of course you need a room to operate the entire thing, and filtered water basin. It's stored at a lower level here. In the sense, here there's a filter, sand is there, comes and fills in here. This is a very, very basic layout, because what happens is a very complicated layout, if you present on this one, it doesn't show up at all. I hope you're able to read what is there, the text. Of course, you'll be able to do it in your, when you take the PowerPoint presentation, you can probably zoom in and all that and see. So, that's about this. This is my reference for much of my lecture today. This is a very basic book, in the sense that it gives very good but very general ideas. It doesn't go too much into the details. But I don't know whether you found it too basic, today's lecture. The principle will not change across anything, be it sewage, be it the drinking water. The process is the same, as in aeration is there, some mixing is there. What you mix in is what is different.
Yeah. Means I am saying that some use membrane, some use anaerobic. For example, I go to the Rajasthan, they use anaerobic. They have 32 chambers. They use anaerobic. It's around 48 hours water stays in it.
Yes.
It doesn't come from there. They use that because they produce the gases. From the gases they produce electricity and use it for a bit.
Okay.
So they use that. And other plant is that they use membrane, CPM.
Yes, I'll just since I showed sand filter. Okay, so in each of the processes which we talk about, there is a problem associated with it. Okay, now maybe if you are talking about this in particular, this will be more relevant to sewage treatment. But I'll just put in a word. I mean, I'll just add this. So, what could be the problem in a sand filter?
Clogging.
Then there is something, there is a chance that odor is caused, because when water, whenever water stagnates, you can have odor problems. Other thing is, it will become a breeding ground for mosquitoes and stuff like that. So I don't know whether it will be nice to go and spray pesticide on that water or not. Then you can also have another thing, there is a very specific fly called Cycoda fly that likes to go in for, and it's a documented nuisance for this water treatment plants, Cycoda fly. So these are some of the things which you can say is a problem with the operation of a sand filter. So you can always think about some things like what is the problem associated with let's say coagulation basin. What could be the problem? Think about it. You can write it down. Okay, or even if what is the filter media, same problem will come, clogging of filters. Okay, sometimes you'll also find that the presence of certain chemicals, for instance zeolite process, you cannot have certain chemicals in the water. If you have that, it will affect the zeolite membrane. What is that? So these sort of things will be required to be learned. It means just do a little bit of reading. Widen your horizons, don't stick to one book, read the same thing in two or three books. Okay, next.
Have you ever wondered where your water comes from when you turn on your tap? Hi, my name is Barry, and today I'm going to show you how your water gets treated. The journey begins here, at Lake Ontario. An intake pipe, big enough to drive a car through, extends 2 kilometers offshore and lies at the bottom of Lake Ontario, 10 meters deep. The end of this pipe is covered by a screen to prevent large pieces of debris from entering the water treatment facility. Let's go there now. We're now at the facility, and I'm going to show you each step of the water treatment process. Here's where water first enters the facility. Every day we can process up to 820 million liters of water. That could fill up to 330 Olympic-sized swimming pools. Once inside the facility, the water flows through these traveling screens, where a copper mesh prevents smaller items like fish and plant life from entering. At the Lakeview Water Treatment Facility, we turn oxygen into ozone. But first, we have to get the oxygen to our facility. The easiest way to transport oxygen is in liquid form. Once it's here, we keep it cool in these large tanks, which is why ice forms even on a summer day like today. We then transport the oxygen into our facility where it's converted into ozone. Let's go take a look. This is the ozone generator room. Inside this generator, an electrical current is passed through the liquid oxygen and converts it into ozone gas. Next, we diffuse the ozone into the water as tiny bubbles. This is part of the disinfection process. The ozonated water remains in these large concrete tanks for 30 minutes before we add sodium bisulfate to quench or remove the ozone before the water moves on to the next step. This makes up the first step of the disinfection process. We'll now look at the next step in water treatment. The disinfected water flows from the ozone contactors to our biologically activated carbon contactors. Here, the water flows in from the top and filters through tiny pieces of carbon which have been heat treated and resemble the carbon found in a home water filter. Harmless bacteria live in the crevices of these tiny carbon pieces. These bacteria consume the organic material broken up by the disinfection process. This step helps to remove a lot of the bad taste and odor from the water. These tanks are 5 meters deep with over 3 meters of biologically activated carbon at the bottom. Every 5 to 7 days, these tanks are backwashed. Clean air and water are forced backwards through the system to break up and flush out anything stuck in the carbon. Next, we'll look at the ultrafiltration membrane process. The water flows from the biologically activated carbon contactors to a series of filter membrane units. The units are made up of tiny membrane fibers like this. This is a model of a membrane fiber. A fiber is a tiny tube with millions of microscopic holes on the outside. We draw water into the tube using vacuum pressure. The holes are so small that only water can pass through, and pathogens, bacteria, and particles are left on the outside. To filter the water on a large scale, we have 12 membrane trains, each holding 55,000 liters of water. Each train has 672 modules. That equals over 282 million membrane fibers. We lifted the cassette from the train, so now we can see the fibers are grouped into modules. Each module is made up of 35,000 fibers. Now the water is clean and almost ready for distribution. These blue pipes collect the clean water from the membrane trains. Before the water heads out to our reservoir, we add a small amount of chlorine to keep the water clean and disinfected as it heads over to your tap. We also add a small amount of fluoride to help promote dental health. As we prepare the water to leave the facility, we constantly monitor its quality to ensure that it meets the Ministry of the Environment's stringent water quality standards. We also test the water manually 4 times a day for over 100 different parameters. And back here in the control rooms, our operators monitor the entire facility and each stage of the water treatment process. For example, they control the backwashing that we saw in the biologically activated carbon contactor gallery. They ensure the membrane trains are functioning properly, and they determine chemical dosages such as ozone. The blue pipes from the facility carry the clean water to an underground reservoir. Reservoirs are huge storage tanks for water and are located all around Peel Region. Pumping stations push the water out into a network of underground water mains that connect to your tap. Water treatment is a complicated process. It takes up to 4 days from the time the water leaves Lake Ontario until it reaches your tap. And it's ready to drink. For more information about water in Peel, contact us at 905-791-7800 or online at www.peelregion.ca.
So both of these were something in Canada, both these videos. What do you feel about this treatment process? What was different here? Instead of?
Yes, they
use membranes. Actually, they did use filters. There was a sand filter at the beginning.
Yeah.
Okay. Sand filters there, and activated carbon is also being used. Okay. And in this one, they didn't talk much about other things. There's not much talk about chlorine and UV. Yes. So the membrane is such that nothing can pass through other than water. So this is what essentially happens in most of the reverse osmosis processes. Here it is ultrafiltration, but reverse osmosis is also concerned with membranes. And please remember, the principle that of underground storage is there in India also. If you look at those tanks, they're huge galleries, very huge. And you will have to keep, it'll look like a big hall with columns, and it'll be columns. The roof might be a dome, or it might even be a flat roof. And it's, you have to think of the buoyancy also, that is when the tank is empty, it should not float off. And the tanks cannot be cast in one piece. So there are watertight joints which have to be thought of. And there's a base raft column, and this one connectivity, crack width is an important criteria. So in case you are going to relate it to your structural design, these are some of the factors which you'll have to take into account. So all these columns and everything will be coated with some material for water tightness, which is also non-toxic. So such tanks will be there near each water treatment facility. Then it is taken to the overhead reservoirs, from where it is pumped. Usually you'll only see the overhead reservoirs, but there's also a very big underground reservoir near each of these overhead tanks. Okay, so I'll just like to also just have a look at our syllabus. So let me open the syllabus. Okay, now of the syllabus, we saw the population forecast and water demand. We had a look at the water treatment objectives. We also saw the unit operations and process in surface water treatment. I personally am talking more about subsurface, because even if it is a so-called surface water, you will be usually using a well or some other method or some other intake structure before you take it. If you looked at Ontario Lake, which they showed, it's 2 kilometers inside the lake, 10 meters below the surface from where they draw water. In fact, the point at which you draw the water is very important. If you are drawing the water from a place which is very, very warm, the chances are that a lot of biological growth could be there. Okay, so temperature also controls the amount of dissolved oxygen. What happens when you elevate the temperature? DO will increase or decrease? Increase. Okay. How many of you have had boiled water in your childhood days at least? Did you like the taste of boiled water or raw water? raw water. Why was raw water tastier?
Everything, it has something to taste.
Okay.
Boiled water, everything gets better.
Yeah. The reason is dissolved oxygen. If you boil it, the oxygen is pushed out. When you are at elevated temperature, dissolved oxygen reduces in fact. Okay, so I just wanted to point it out to you. When you elevate temperature, dissolved oxygen comes down. So in fact, when you have water, hot water bath in your this one, and you are sending it into your drain, one of the things you are also doing is, already the dissolved oxygen is less in your drain, you are making it even lesser. It becomes more septic. Of course, I also bathe in hot water. I shouldn't be telling much, but I do feel guilty about it. But this is the fact that happens. And the only way you can bring it back is by agitating the water or something, where you introduce the atmospheric air into the water again. So this is the reason why your boiled water doesn't taste all that good. Here, so then we have the principles and functions and design of flash mixer. So the principle of flash mixing is, it is done rapidly. It is done rapidly so that the chemicals are mixed through. Okay, so function also, it comes for the flash mixer. Then you got flocculators. They have to be at a particular speed so that flocks form. Too less, energy is not there for flock formation. Too much, it will break it into pieces. Okay, sedimentation tanks. It can be just gravity settling, which is there. Or you can go for the thickener sort of clarifiers, which have a different build itself. Aerate and remove what? Flocks, yes. Okay. But I am talking about sedimenting large pieces. Sedimenting large pieces. Okay. Aeration, two things. One, you increase the dissolved oxygen levels. It will be also a disinfection process. And also, it might be a requirement for a process. Please remember, aeration can be also a process requirement. So, for instance, if you are going to go for biological reactors, which is aerobic, you need to have dissolved oxygen in the system. Iron and manganese removal, I have not, this chemical things I have not touched. Okay, next lecture I will definitely do it. Iron and manganese, defluoridization, demineralization and water treatment. Okay, and second thing is very, very simple. This unit operations, with your permission, I will not be dealing too much, okay, in the second unit. Principles, function and design of screen, bar screens, okay, grit chambers. Bar screen and grit chambers are very similar. Bar screens are just bars which will not let wood go through. The grit chamber is something like what we saw in this one. Like he was talking about fish and all not getting caught, right? That sort of thing is a grit chamber. And primary sedimentation tanks, they are just large tanks where the velocity of water is brought to such a level that sedimentation will take place. Please remember, whenever there is a lot of energy, the material cannot sediment. That is a very fundamental principle. Water still looks clear, but the moment a child runs into the water, it starts to get turbid. Okay, so if it's clay, it will become very turbid. If it is sand, you can see sand mixing, but it will again settle as soon as energy is not there. So the larger the particles, settling is faster. That is why we go for all this flocculation and other techniques. Okay, so basically I was thinking that the three units was doable. However, I am going to still stick to two units for the exam. Okay, now I will stop this lecture saying thank you. Okay, and we will just discuss what we are going to do for our assignment for today. Okay.